Pleasure to introduce, thank you, Jacqueline, for recording, and welcome everyone to this RQMP seminar. It is my pleasure to introduce Anne Kietzig, who is an associate professor at McGill's Chemical Engineering Department. She's a new member of RQMP, even though she's been at McGill since 2010. And as a new member, we always like new members to visit different RQMP institutions, but now we're all together, so we can just have it together now. She already gave a talk at McGill Physics Department, and now everybody else can hear about her work. So Anne did her diploma, I believe, at the Technical University of Berlin. And after that, she moved to Canada and did her doctoral studies at Department of Biological and Chemical Engineering at UBC. And she graduated in 2010 and right after was snatched by McGill. And she's been at McGill ever since. And today she leads research in the biomimetic surface engineering. And she focuses on two things, laser material interactions and also surface wetting. So Anne, welcome to our QMP again. I guess it's been at least a year since you're with us. And please, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you, Tammy. Thank you for the introduction. And well, as a little disclaimer, since you know we're all sitting at home, I have the snow removal operation of Montreal in front of my house. So in case it gets really loud, this one, I'm with my headphones here. In case it gets really loud, I guess I'll just stop talking, or you raise a hand, or you tell me that you don't hear me anymore, or I don't know what. So I guess that comes with home office teaching or presenting. And well, my apologies to my colleagues from physics, because this talk is not that different to the one I've given last year. First of all, because of COVID, not that much happened for about half a year. And well, the introduction is basically the same as you've already seen. So Dave, that might be terribly boring for you because you've seen that many, many times. Well, I'm really pleased to present to those of you who don't know me yet or who haven't heard that presentation yet, the gist of my research, what my research team has been working on. And so the talk is titled Femtosecond Laser Micromachining of Materials to Engineer Functional Surfaces. And as Tammy has presented before, whoops, now this is not moving forward. I'm probably on the wrong window. Here we go. We take inspiration a lot from nature's surfaces. And nature has a lot of splendid examples of surfaces that provide functionality, like what we see up top here, the blue morpho butterfly. That is showing this metallic, brilliant, very bright blue color, in spite of not using any toxic or aggressive chemicals, dyes or pigments. Examples that, well, might be interesting for Dave and his leaking problem in the lab. Going back to the hydrophobicity of surfaces, an example that I'm giving here is watercress. You might have heard about the lotus leaf a lot, and I just got tired by the lotus, so I used another plant. Another example would be the tree frog. As you see here, the tree frog basically is climbing onto leaves that are super wet and actually would appear to be super slippery, but it can cling on and can continue climbing. And just one further example, here's the cicada insect. They're not only transparent wings, but those wings are also of antibacterial like nature, which makes them as an interesting example presently. Especially where, you know, the industry and governments are thriving to get some ideas for having antibacterial antivirus surfaces. The common feature of these four examples that I've given you here is basically that we have a nano micro structured surface. On each example, I've provided a little SEM image there, and you see that all these surfaces come with intricate surface structure. And that is a bit the overarching topic behind what I'm presenting here. So when we consider nature's surfaces, we can basically differentiate out, well, that's an image from a textbook, but seven prominent functions. And they range from transport barrier over surface wettability, anti-adhesive self-cleaning properties, to signaling, optical properties, mechanical properties, and temperature control. And all of these basically go back to the topology or the texture of a particular surface. So in my research, we really focus on those from B to F, not so much G, not so much A. That is what I want to present to you here today. With that, a general comparison of nature's examples I have shown you before. They all have very intricate surface structures. They are all somewhat random, but nevertheless regular. And many of those come with a microstructure that has a superimposed nanostructure on top of that. Now in engineering, we can do that too. We can do that very nicely, like on the right-hand side, and many of you probably do. These are examples from a photolithography process. That is fantastic because in comparison to my left-hand example, here I have very clear-cut dimensions, a height, a width. I can calculate things from a mathematical perspective, thermodynamic equations apply very easily. I have a unit cell and I can extrapolate it to a huge surface. So that's convenient to understand the fundamentals. When we consider the fabrication process, we can only, very often, most processes, we can only produce one length scale per processing step. And often those processing steps come with rather complicated equipment or infrastructure. So if we consider lithography, might need a clean room, might need high vacuum equipment. So those features are nice for fundamental studies, and surfaces with such features are nice for fundamental studies, not so applicable to real industrial applications. And that is where I guess I see my research coming in, where we can make both, maybe not as nice as those lithography structures, but we can make fairly clean structures of micrometric, nanometric dimensions. And we can also create random structures that have certain functionality. And we do that by laser micromachining. Now, here I have a couple of examples for the major challenges that we face in surface engineering when we consider the industrial applications. And they range from ice inhibition, and I guess a good example for those of you who are in Montreal right now, to solar panels where you want to have rather black surfaces, so you want a certain coloration. Self-emptying containers, heat transfer in cooling towers are the examples here. The traditional solution to those is to use processes or coatings that require a lot of energy or water, and very often not so green chemicals. Now, if we consider nature's examples against that, obviously nature doesn't use a lot of energy, water, or non-green chemicals, but everything is biodegradable. It comes, however, with specific adaptability to a very precise niche. Now, whereas in engineering applications, we usually try to cover a much broader spectrum. So there's a bit of a trade-off to be considered here. Nevertheless, those natural examples work quite well as a first starting point to take inspiration from and to move on from there and maybe taking another approach to a common surface engineering problem. And in the bottom line here, I'm providing you a couple of examples from my own lab, which are addressing those examples at the top, be it ice inhibition, self-cleaning containers, heat transfer, or coloration. Actually, I have to make that disclaimer. That little piece of art is not from my lab. This copper piece with the different colors we've made, but we didn't go all the way to actually create the piece of art. It's a lab from France that has played around enough to make a piece of art out of that. So with respect to the talk today, I, in the interest of time, I will mainly focus on the light matter interactions and the basics of the liquid solid interactions. And I will not really go into the applications per se. If there are any questions, obviously I have a bunch of backup slides and I'm happy to address any of these. But what I want to cover here today is really more where we're coming from and what we do with the laser to create those functional surfaces. But feel free to interrupt me at any time if you have any questions, or I can emphasize on something else. So starting off with the light matter interactions, what we're using is kind of the standard femtosecond laser, the Thai sapphire amplifier. The little setup is shown here, but what is important is that we get with that approach functionality on the substrate material in a single process step. As you will see later on, we can get multiple length scales in one single process step and at the same time influence the surface chemistry. We can process any type of material, metal, semiconductors, and we can choose the environment in which we want to do so. And taking all those three aspects together, we can then really exploit the possibilities that the laser system gives us for the applications of choice. Now here I've given a couple of examples of the surfaces we make. On the left-hand side, you see what we call laser inscribed structures, kind of self-organized, maybe resembling a little bit to what you've seen before in the natural examples. We can make those of a bit more defined geometry. We'll call them laser inscribed structures. The examples to the left here are metal surfaces. To the right here, these are polymeric surfaces. Again, a laser inscribed structure at the bottom and a laser induced structure at the top. I'm going a bit more into that difference in the following. So as I said, we differentiate. We can make so many structures, but at some point it just gets too complicated to give them all names and to somehow differentiate between them. So as a guideline also for this talk, I differentiate, as I already did, between laser inscribed structures and laser induced structures. Laser inscribed structures are somehow like if you would take a knife and carve into wood. So those structures as shown here with the green box around are those that are carved out of the material. Therefore, the feature sizes of the channels are larger than the beam diameter that I'm using. On the other hand, the laser irradiated structures or induced structures are those that appear by self-organization processes that I don't dictate exactly where I want to have which feature, but those features are either those periodic nanostructures, so ripples as we call them in the field, or nanoparticle agglomerates like shown here. And I don't have a very good influence on where a particular nanoparticle lands on here, but I make use of the fact that they redeposit on the surface. And as you can see, any laser inscribed structure will come to a certain degree with a laser induced structure. So those nanoparticle clusters you see up on the top of those bumps here. And if I would have zoomed in more on the side of those bumps, you would see those ripple structures as shown over here. So this is where we get two dimensions of roughness onto one single surface. Now those periodic nanostructures are especially relevant for structural color. And those microstructures of whatever geometry are very relevant for tuned wetting and adhesion applications. And I've been mentioning a bit before, and I get back in a tiny bit to the wetting later on. Now, considering what's actually happening when my laser pulses hit my surface. Overall, in all our surface machining, we raster scan. So as indicated here, moving over, up, back, and back and forth motion. Now we synchronize that to make those fancy structures with basically shutting the beam off and on, like a light switch. So if we do that at a specific position and we do it at the next specific position in the next line, we can create hexagons, circles, whatever you name it. Like we can write names, typically in grading process. So it comes down to synchronizing the machining directions with the laser light coming in or not. When a single laser beam pulse hits a surface, we basically have to consider the Gaussian distribution in time and space. So my laser beam or my laser pulse hits the surface, I will get a heat affected zone right where the remaining surface is. That is fairly small for ultra short pulses. We have next to the heat affected zone, we have a shock affected zone. And then the black field here you see right there is a tiny little melt layer that, depending on the pulse duration, is longer or shorter. In our cases, it's very often very small, very minimal, negligible. And then we have plasma expansion in the direction of the incoming beam most often. And also the material that has been ablated is carried away as the plasma or in the format of nanoparticles. Again, something I will address a little later. Now, This is not moving forward. Why is that not moving forward? Here we go. So when we consider the Gaussian distribution in space, we basically have the highest energy intensity in the center of our pulse. And then the energy is ebbing off towards the trailing ends of the Gaussian distribution. And that's happening in 3D. So we have in the center a damaged area, and around that we have an irradiated area that doesn't show visual damage, but that material nevertheless has encountered the laser beam or the pulses and shows slightly different behavior under subsequent irradiation. So when we do this raster scan process, we basically raster our individual laser pulses in very short distance one from the other and along a line. With that, this 3D Gaussian distribution basically turns into a 2D one. And that's what I'm trying to indicate here with my shadings, that I still have the highest energy intensity in the center of the line, and then it's ebbing off to the sides. Now that's somehow, to a certain degree, convenient and inconvenient for micromachining. So what we do subsequently is we overlap those lines at each come with their Gaussian distribution. To indicate that a bit more scientifically, here these gray curves are an individual line, and now you see the next one would be the subsequent line that's overlapping, and so on. And so I get an accumulated energy or affluence profile or across my surface, depending on the degree of overlap. In this case, I'm illustrating a 50% overlap. Here would be an 80% overlap. So the closer those lines come together, the smoother the accumulated profile eventually is. In the end, if I zoom in here into my plateau, we'll still have a tiny little amplitude there, but that becomes negligible at a certain extent. So for making homogeneous surfaces, that is of great advantage, because overall any spot on my surface experiences the same energy input into the surface. And that's what we make use of if we want to make homogeneous surface structures like those periodic ripple structures, nanostructures that you've seen before. So for metallic surfaces, so I basically want to differentiate out metals and polymers here right now, because these are two big examples that I'm using right now in this presentation. As you all know, the energy is transferred to the surface electrons, which then cool down through electron diffusion, electron-phonon interaction. Now in femtosecond laser micromachining, we're faster than the heat transfer that we teach in our undergraduate courses. Heat transfer typically somewhere around that length, time scale, picosecond to nanoseconds, but we are faster. So what is important for the heat transfer in our case is that we have that competition between the electron thermalization, which is shown here, and the electron lattice energy exchange. And that is expressed in this two temperature model that I'm indicating here with these two differential equations. Without going into the details of the math, the relevant parameters, the relevant material parameters that are important to us are the thermal conductivity and the electron-phonon coupling constant. And I give you examples just in a second. Furthermore, the resolidification time and the repetition rate, with respect to the repetition rate, are also of importance, because if my metallic melt is redesolidified to a metal before the next pulse hits, I have metal-light interaction. If I still have a melt, I have a dielectric for the next pulse to interact with. And the dynamics are quite different, and therefore the resulting features and the resulting structures are quite different. So that's a fine balance to hit between resolidification time and the repetition rate that we actually use in our machining processes. So here I'm giving you a couple of examples. Basically, we've been machining single lines on different materials. And I like that example. It's basically just a tiny little experiment, but it illustrates quite well the influence of the electron-phonon coupling constant and the thermal conductivity. Titanium, listed up here, has the highest electron-phonon coupling, but the lowest thermal conductivity among my four materials of comparison here, which makes that the energy is kind of stuck on the surface and is not being transported away or diffused away into the material, which, however, is the case for copper. So if I'm looking for what types of surfaces I can achieve with a given material, those two parameters are of foremost interest, because if I have a material such as stainless steel or titanium, I can achieve those laser-induced self-organized structures quite easily, because you see all those kind of formations there. Whereas if I want to make something inscribed, where I want very clear geometries and not too much self-organization there, I better go with a material such as aluminum or copper that has a very low electron-phonon coupling constant, but therefore a high thermal conductivity. So I get those clean-cut structures. And I'm just giving you here the two examples. Typical surfaces that we where we get kind of bumpy structures, hole formations, kind of some labyrinth structures. That's what we see on titanium. Whereas on copper, we can get those very defined, for example, here concentric rings or hole features that might be interesting for one or the other application. As I mentioned before, even on those inscribed structures here, we will always have, to a certain degree, those nanostructures, these laser-induced structures. So I think that's as far as I want to go into the details for metals. When we consider the light-matter interaction for polymers, well, obviously, there are no free electrons. And polymers are highly susceptible to photochemical reactions. So that is something we need to keep in consideration. The structure formation basically results from explosive boiling and the rapid quenching that they experience upon the femtosecond irradiation. And what is important for us here from the material processing perspective is the band gap, or the cutoff wavelength, where the absorption characteristics change. Furthermore, molecular weight has a very big influence on the way a bubble from that explosive boiling process can actually grow. Providing a couple of examples here. So what we see is that basically any polymer that is processed beyond its cutoff wavelength will show some kind of porous network structure, as seen here. And they all pretty much resemble one another. We will get porous networks that result from this explosive boiling and then rapid quenching process. Now, that is that laser-induced structure again. We can't do anything against it. We cannot laser process a polymer without getting that porosity. However, we can inscribe into a polymer just as we can do that into a metal, but in the trench where the laser beam passed, we will see that porosity, like shown here, or that in this example here, we overscanned also the ridges on the top. So we got the same porosity at the top and at the bottom of a trench. So this is a shark skin imitate here that I've demonstrated there. Now, a bit more details with respect to the polymers. We have done experiments with polyethylene. Polyethylene is a fantastic material to play with because it comes with very many different grades and many different molecular weights, even though keeping everything else constant. So that's really nice to experiment with. And as you can see here, with increasing molecular weight, but the same chemistry, we basically get smaller pores at the same fluence that is being used for the machining. And taking grade 4 as an example out here and considering it under a CT scan, those pores are interconnected throughout the, well, that layer that was machined. Underneath, obviously, there's the bulk, the solid. But that top layer has a porosity, in this case, of 45%. And it's all interconnected pores. So that is something that is interesting for some filtration processes or scaffold cell growth experiments. Now, the other thing that we noticed or that was interesting to experience, and this is specifically for the example of polyethylene, is that the lattice structures of the crystalline regions changed from the pristine material to the laser machined material. More precisely, whereas we see in polyethylene, typically an orthorhombic lattice, up in the laser machining process, we have a monoclinic lattice. And that is one that we typically see only under very high pressures and very high temperatures. Otherwise, it's not stable. But because the laser energy is there and then gone before any equilibrium process could return that situation back to the energetically more favorable one under ambient conditions. This is already quenched. This structure is already frozen. So we actually transform from here to there. And then with respect to the bubble growth, I just want to show you the complex viscosity with experiments with respect to the four different grades here. So with increasing molecular weight, no big surprise, the viscosity is decreasing. And so with less and less viscosity, my material has less of a tendency to give way to those forming bubbles. So those bubbles cannot expand to an as big size as they did in this case. Therefore, I get smaller pore sizes with higher molecular weight materials than I do for the low molecular weight ones. So I hope that just gave you a bit of an insight of what is happening when the laser hits certain materials. I'm skipping the ceramics right now, just in the interest of time. And we'll move on from here. Oh, I've just mentioned that. Should have brought that earlier. I want to conclude here. So basically, I hope I've given you the overview that with that process of laser micro machining, we can create multi-tier roughness, so more than one length scale of roughness, in a single processing step. And we can do that in, like, all the experiments I've shown you up to now were processed in ambient air. We can do it like in different gases, but ambient air is cheapest and it's easiest to do. So moving on from here, I want to basically present to you the first introduction into the solid-liquid interactions and also give you the reason of why it might be interesting to not machine in air, but in other environments. So that's a very broad and very brief introduction to surface wettability, but you probably all know that we differentiate surfaces into being wettable or water repellent, depending on how a droplet beads up or spreads out on that surface. So if we have a hydrophilic surface and we roughen that hydrophilic surface up, it will become more hydrophilic. If we have a hydrophobic surface and we roughen that up, it will become more hydrophobic. And that has been shown, like, by now, 90 years ago, almost 90 years ago, by Wenzel. In that nice little graph, we have the contact angle that the droplet forms with the surface, plotted against a roughness ratio. And that roughness ratio is just the bird's eye view of a surface, or the actual surface area with respect to the bird's eye view of the surface. So absolutely super polished flat surface will have a roughness ratio of 1. And then the rougher it gets, the higher this roughness ratio is. Now, as you can already see from that very simplistic graph, is that the math of the graph breaks down once we get to very high roughnesses. Basically tells you that if you had a surface that had initially a contact angle of, let's say, well, 60 degree, and you roughen it up to more than double its surface area, well, then you have a completely spreading surface and your graph doesn't continue on there anymore. And that is not quite true. Because if we roughen, no matter whether the material is hydrophilic or hydrophobic, if we texture a material in such a way that the texture entraps air, then it doesn't matter whether my initial underlying material is hydrophilic or hydrophobic, the resulting wettability will be that of a non-wettable surface, and the drop will bead up because it's partially carried by air and only partially by the actual surface. So the actual liquid surface interaction is much smaller than predicted in this case, because we're supported by air and the contact angle of air and water is 180 degree. So this is what, here I have the example of the lotus leaf, what we see in nature. And here you see the typical features of the lotus leaf. And that's what you've probably heard in the press. That's the lotus effect, which is that a droplet will be carried by those bumps up top here and will hardly penetrate into the valleys of the surface over there. So I want to show you here that we can do the same thing and that we've done the same thing. On the top row, you see that for a metal illustrator, the bottom for a polymer. So the metal example that I've chosen here is one with square pillars that we have nicely machined into our copper surface. And the little insert here shows you that on the top, we have those nanostructure agglomerates. On the side, we have a smaller structure. So we have basically a hierarchical roughness structure with a microstructure that has a superimposed nanostructure on top of it. And what you see to the right-hand side here is the view through water onto the surface. That might take a moment to grasp that. So basically, that's a confocal image with a liquid immersion lens. So we're looking through the liquid onto the surface, and what we see up here are basically those pillars right here, the tops, or as indicated in the rendering right here. All the gray zone in the middle in between here is the suspended water. That's basically hanging there like a hammock. So obviously we've succeeded in making a surface that is entrapping the air and therefore suspending the liquid water front, the liquid air front. So here I'm showing that for the example of a super engineered surface, extremely regular. The polymer example, as I've indicated before, in the polymer, we always get that porosity. So even if I make a very nice pillar structure on top of this pillar structure, I have that kind of a porous structure. And again, we're looking through the top, through the water onto the surface. And you can see that only some peaks of those porous features here are actually visible. And the rest is just the water-air interface. And here we have a side view as well. So you clearly see that in here, there's a big air gap, another big air gap, and another big air gap. But obviously on the polymer, it's not as regular because the porosity here is just not of a defined distance each single time.
Yeah?
Yes.
How thick is the water in this sort of hammock?
It's everything is water. Like I'm looking from within the water.
Oh, okay. So it's basically water all the way down, or is it really suspended film?
No, it's a suspended film, but like basically okay. This, like what I'm trying to illustrate here, it's basically a suspended film. You could imagine that up here, that's all the water drop. Basically, like you have the objective, gotcha. And then you have the drop hanging there, and down here is my surface.
Yep, got it. Thanks.
Any other questions? I know that's a bit tricky to grasp the first time you see that. So basically, what I wanted to show you is that we're quite successful in making super hydrophobic surfaces out of no matter what material, as long as we get the structure in such a way that we trap air. However, for metals, the story is a bit more complicated, and because aside from the structure alone, there's also an effect happening with respect to the surface chemistry. Now, these are images from my PhD, but I always stick them out again because, you know, it was kind of the first images or the first results on that field. So when we have a polished metal, we have a fairly hydrophilic surface, and that is one of roughly 70 degree contact angle. Then we laser machine that, and here I used a laser-induced structure, a bumpy structure, and not surprisingly, according to the graph I've shown you before, or the model of Wenzel, the droplet is spreading out. But now, after a couple of weeks, I did the measurement again, and I got that. And so at that time, first idea was, oh, contamination, something didn't quite go right. And then we repeated the experiment over and over, and by now many research groups have repeated that over and over. The surface changes its wetting response with time. So whereas initially, the droplet is completely spreading out, and why you see a curvature here is only because the patch that we laser machined is so small that the water couldn't spread out further. And then with time, the drop basically beads up. That's not the same drop. It would have evaporated in the meantime. So that's basically a new drop every other day or so. And then in not a video, but a screenshot here, you can see that when you suspend a drop, you push the liquid in, which I'm doing in the first two steps, and then I'm sucking it back out again, the contact area doesn't change at all. The drop volume changes, but the contact area doesn't change, and then it just released once I'm not pushing. I don't have enough volume anymore to push the drop onto the surface. So something is happening with respect to the surface chemistry, because the surface structure, the surface features stay the same. Now on the little video inserts, and I hope you can see that on your screens, but on the top right corner, you see a super hydrophobic surface. On the bottom left corner there, you see a superhydrophilic surface. The bottom one we're spraying with mist. As you can maybe see, it's getting darker and darker, and like a sponge in your kitchen, it's basically absorbing the water and it's just filling in. The only change that you see is that from gray it gets to black because it's filling up with water. And if you watch really, really closely, you will see a drop forming at some point here at the bottom, because I didn't have a thread or anything for the drop to, for the water to flow away. On the top image, you might have seen that I was trying to get the drop onto the surface. It didn't want to stick. Then I made a mistake and went in between those black lace patches, which is where the drop adhered and stuck to there in the end. Both surfaces were made with the same process that I've shown you before, but they were treated differently right after the laser process. So that sample here was exposed to air, could have been exposed to CO2 as well and would have gone faster, I'll show you in a second. This surface here has been dropped into boiling water. So this is still an older image, but we've mastered that a bit better by now. I'll show you that in a moment. But basically it depends on what medium you're laser machining in and what is happening right after the laser machining process. So you might remember that I had mentioned and emphasized the two temperature model and the non-equilibrium effects that are basically happening with this ultra-fast laser radiation on the surface. And we don't give time for traditional normal heat transfer to happen, but we're faster. So we're using a lot of non-equilibrium effects, also a lot of non-stoichiometry into the chemistry. Now, I can't go into super great detail because it's still not super well understood. What we hypothesize is that, or what we know is that the chemistry is disrupted. We get an active surface, and that active surface is reacting with its surroundings. If we expose it to water, we end up with a superhydrophilic surface. If we have exposed it for water for long enough, so a 12-hour exposure in addition to the laser machining, we actually get the superhydrophilicity with completely spreading. If we expose it not long enough and go to CO2 right after, the carbon in the CO2 takes over an important role and is basically screening that hydrophilicity to a certain degree, and we get to an intermediate wettability. On the other hand, if we never let our surfaces get in contact with water, but only with CO2, we get into super high contact angles. So Tanya has mentioned before, I did my PhD in Vancouver. You might not know much about Vancouver, but you probably know that it's raining there a lot. So it makes a hell of a lot of a difference whether you do those experiments in the winter or in the summer. So I didn't get the same results, obviously, when I did them in the winter, where it was fairly dry and I get very nicely hydrophobic surfaces when I just exposed them to air. And I didn't get that in the winter. And so that's in the end the reason for why it's very important in that process to have tight control over the environmental conditions. And you want to make sure that, especially after the process, you control the humidity or the exposure environment of your samples so that whatever reaction is going on comes to completion before you put those samples into application. But the interesting thing is, or I guess the powerful thing is, that we can tune the wetting behavior somewhat as if we would like we need it for a certain application. So we can do that on metals directly by influencing the surface chemistry. We can do that indirectly on polymers by using a pulsed laser deposition process synchronously or after the polymer machining. So again, you see those polymer networks that I've shown before. And if we synchronously or asynchronously now irradiate that polymer network with, we don't irradiate it directly, we actually expose it to metallic nanoparticles that we ablast with the second laser beam from a titanium target in this case. Then we decorate this mesh surface here with our titanium nanoparticles. And because they are highly hydrophilic, we basically can tune the hydrophilicity or the wetting response of our polymer just as well. So in this case, we did not want the hydrophobic behavior of this material because it was supposed to be used for implants. And we needed something a bit more hydrophilic. So it was decorated with those nanoparticles. And that's a way, maybe not the best, but it's one way of tuning also the wettability of polymers that have been irradiated with a laser or fabricated with a laser. So to like complete that discussion, these are experiments that I've presented a year ago as, oh, we're going to start them in 2 weeks. I can basically make the same comment right now, unfortunately, because, well, there was the shutdown, then the instrument was down, then the pump was leaking, and you know how things go. So we're still there. I can still make the same comment. I'm still super hopeful to have results on that in 4 weeks, but I've said that a year ago already, so maybe I don't say that again. The idea that we have is that we irradiate in an enclosed environment of a very specific and controlled atmosphere. Now we then transfer that small little reactor into the glove box. That was the last thing that was broken over Christmas. So that we don't have any air exposure in between. And then from the glove box, we transfer our samples into this vacuum transfer module that goes into the XPS. And so we can do the chemical analysis, not really while we machine, but shortly after we machine and without any exposure to ambient air that is, you know, every day different and really influences the response that are reported in the research field. So very many researchers have done interesting XPS analysis on their laser machine samples, going directly from here to here, but doing that in air. And this is probably why my first paper has gotten so many citations, because results are extremely controversial. And they are extremely controversial because everything is exposed to air. So you're measuring all and everything, but not really what that surface does. So we try to fix that, and maybe one day we'll manage. However, one particular problem that we have with that is that typically after laser machining, we sonicate our surfaces to get rid of nanoparticle debris that is not sintered to the surface. Now, if I want to do chemical analysis, I can't possibly take my samples out and put them into a sonication bath. So we needed to find another way. And what we did is we applied an electric charge to a collection plate and kind of turned the pulsed laser deposition process that I've illustrated before around. So that's what I'm showing here. So we have a collection plate, and you have to imagine that enclosed into the reactor. That collection plate is there to collect the nanoparticles off the surface. So PLD basically means I'm doing that in atmospheric air, I'm not doing anything else. And we can see that no matter whether I'm machining copper, titanium, or silicon, my collection plate didn't collect anything. If I do that with a floating potential applied to it, we collect quite a bit in kind of different shapes. Nanoparticles get accumulated, get attracted by those collection plates, and we're successful in withdrawing them A, from the surface, B, from the environment, because that stuff that is being like breathed in by the operator. In our lab, we have, I guess, a fairly good suction system set up, but those lasers and those laser systems are being used for big applications where the exhaust or the health risk of those particles is not necessarily considered. So that's just as a side comment. Well, finally, we also did that with an electric field being applied to it. And as you can see, the nanoparticles are also collected, but the collection pattern is quite different and very condensed. So without going into much detail, further detail here, what we found is that the best procedure is to go with a floating potential because we're collecting most nanoparticles. However, we don't quite achieve our goal yet, because even after this collection process, we still have nanoparticle clusters on the surface. So we have a little less than in just the PLD process, which is great, but by sonication, we still remove a majority of it. So what we achieved is we have now a nice approach in collecting our nanoparticles and having them ready for chemical analysis after. However, we have not yet achieved to really get them off the surface without any post-treatment that involves a solvent or a sonication bath or any other abrasive method that would expose the surface to air. So that's ongoing work. So with that, I guess I just want to wrap up. I hope I've shown you that with the femtosecond laser micromachining process, We have successful machining nanomicrometric surface structures, and we can, in one single process step, induce texture on different length scales. So we achieve those hierarchically structured surfaces, and we can do so on any material. You have to trust me, the any material, because I didn't show, in the interest of time, any ceramic other examples than the standard polymers and the metals. We differentiate between those laser-induced and laser-inscribed structures, whether we are larger or smaller than the beam, and how we use our beam. We basically present a monolithic resolution. We don't need any other coating. We don't need a coating procedure that will peel off after time. And it's a basically one process step approach. Now, with that laser radiation, we don't only influence the surface texture, we also influence the surface chemistry. And whereas that wetting-based functionality and that chemistry behind it is fairly poorly understood, we nevertheless exploit it for a lot of applications, which I now didn't discuss, but I've shown you a few here. And if you're interested, I can always respond to questions regarding those. So with that, I'm happy that I somehow stayed in time. I thank all the people that have involved in all those images and graphs that I've shown here. And well, I thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Anne, for this lovely talk. And thank you also for being on time. So if people have questions, this is a good time. You don't have to wait for the permission to speak. You can just unmute yourself and ask your question.
I had a question about, so this textured surface. So recently I was walking in the woods and I noticed these weird ice formations that were coming out of the ground, and they were growing essentially like needles. So it's apparently a well-known thing. So it's called needle ice, but it's sort of directional freezing, and it's done by structuring the surface and the particular soil and the source of the water. I was wondering if by controlling the wettability and the structures on the surface, are you also able to control the freezing of water? Because I would imagine living in Canada, that's a big problem, right?
Indeed. So I can maybe go two slides back. You see a little bit of that. But basically the freezing of water is primarily influenced by where does the cold or the heat come from? Mm-hmm. So, that is something that, from the structural perspective, we can't influence that much. That really depends on where's the heat source or the cold source coming from. So in applications like the airplane, it's the wind around, so we can't do anything about that. Mm-hmm. We can do something about the adhesion of that ice to the surface. So that is where a lot of research is going into, and that is what the penguin kind of shows here, or our version of the penguin that is shown there, mm-hmm. Where we basically try to influence the adhesion strength to the surface. I can't talk much about that particular application, however. So you will have to wait till the IP thing is under control. But yes, we can influence it.
Okay, cool, thanks.
Maybe I had the question. Thanks for a very interesting talk. Once you have ablated the surface, it becomes very rough. And then the second pulse is partly located on that rough surface. And then the next row is not, is partly influenced by the previous row. So how does that affect the process, let's say, and then you showed, for example, these pillars, the top seems to be very rough. So how much that roughness influences the properties of the surface compared to the pillars themselves?
Okay, so thanks, great questions. I'll start with the first one. So you're absolutely right, because we continuously move under the pulsation, we don't, My next pulse never sees a completely pristine surface like my very first one did. So if you have a single pulse experiment on any material, you should see if your beam is nicely formed, you should see a very clean imprint of a round circular beam on that surface. And that's what you do with a single pulse. Now, if you do, however, translate your pulses as we do, you kind of see those ovals. And you will always see that from the direction from which you're coming from, you have more of those material matter interactions. So just like visually under the SEM, you would see a stronger response on where the previous pulses have been. So in our calculations or models, we typically consider the pulses per spot. So we don't consider the entire area, we consider a spot. We actually count how many pulses we have. And then things like incubation come into play, where the ablation threshold changes with the number of pulses that have already been like subjected to the surface. So we know that there are models for that to approach that. And in the end, what we try to do is to always keep the same displacement, so that at least that is compensated by the fact that my entire surface area sees the same kind of difference all along. Does that respond to your question?
And for a second part, the fact that for example, the part is
Exactly. So you're absolutely right. So on the top of our pillars, we have, I want to go back to the slide. This is where I want to go, here. So here we see it quite clearly. So on the top of those surfaces, we have those nanostructures here. So what we can't see under the confocal because the magnification isn't good enough is that, but what we expect is that those porous structures up top here basically behave like the microstructure here. So if we could zoom in more, what I would expect to see and what is actually also happening is that between those nano features, air also gets trapped and doesn't seep in. So you have that, what I simplified here onto a one scale phenomenon, this water interface hanging between the pillars. You also have that on top of those features, and that is what we actually want. And that is exactly what the Lotus, for example, is doing. Like, I can go back to my slide for that. That was just one back. If you carefully look here, we have those macro scale bumps, and then on top of those we have those little hairy structures. So in between those hairs, there's no water penetrating in there either. So the actual surface area, the interface between the liquid and the solid, is really minimal. And so that's the benefit in using this laser process, where I have somehow that nuisance of redepositing nanoparticles. I also benefit from that because I don't have a smooth surface, but I have a nano rough surface. I hope that responds.
Okay. Any other?
I have a question, if I may. Thank you for your talk. I was just wondering if you change anything significantly for micro machining insulators or ceramics, as you said, and also if you have tried to do these micro machining processes in a cryostat or in like some extreme conditions at lower temperatures. Have you tried changing the temperature? So one of the effects that might be interesting for you is to change the thermal conductivity. If you go to very low temperatures or very high temperatures, you can affect that. So yes, I have these two questions. Thank you.
So I address your first one first. So what happens when we consider like other materials? The big difference is, for example, if we consider ceramics, the bonds are different, right, that we have to break. So we need much more energy. Something that on a metal will give me, for example, where I can quite easily get a trench of 100 micrometers, will take me much more effort, much more energy on a ceramic. So that's the key difference there. With respect to extreme temperatures, we've operated in vacuum. That's what we've done, ultra-high vacuum. And it's very interesting to see what the plasma plume does in this case and how different the machining outcome is. Overall, the same features on the surface will result. The features that we want, we can still get them under vacuum conditions. So from the application point of view, it is not extremely interesting to operate under vacuum because you can get the same thing in air and it's cheaper. On the other hand, from the fundamental scientific point of view, it is quite interesting because you can control your plasma plume, you can control what's happening with respect to your surface chemistry also much better. So the more fundamental experiments are running on that respect. What we haven't done is going to cryo temperatures or playing a lot with the temperature of our substrates. We've increased the temperature a bit because it was supposed to help us in the machining, according to some reports, but we haven't gone to anything extreme that would have required more safety precautions in the lab or other setups. So there's work being done by a group from Nebraska, University of Wisconsin. They've been doing a bit more with respect to high temperatures, however. I don't really know that anybody has done a lot on the cryo side of things.
Thank you. Thank you. And for the increasing the laser energy, can you be more quantitative? Quantitative on this. So for example, for making the same groove with the same diameter, same size, you have to increase the laser power. How much?
Again, it depends on the exact ceramic. So it's not super easy to give you like as a real, it's really a ballpoint number, 10 to 20 times.
Oh, okay.
And that's with respect to one that we've recently worked on. But now in comparison to copper, already if I compare copper to stainless steel, I have a fivefold increase, like a change to get the same depth. So it's not a one-to-one calculation. There's not one single simple linear model that I could give you. So this is why it's really just a number that I'm giving you just to show you it's a lot more energy, but then again, it depends on the exact material that we're dealing with.
I see, thank you. Thank you very much.
Great, are there any more questions? Okay, if not, we're right on time. So thank you, Anne, again. And everyone, hope to see you next week at the same time, same place. Thank you.